nice to meet you all. My name's Dan Jagodzinski. You already know me. And welcome to Fermi in the Future. This is exploring the Fermi Paradox and its effects on human interstellar interactions. Okay. Hello. Thank everyone for coming. Welcome to Fermi in the Future. This is exploring the Fermi Paradox and its effects on human interstellar interactions. On any given night, one can look skyward and receive a profound sense of smallness when observing the cosmos. To gain perspective, we must try to understand our inherent lack of empirical knowledge when looking beyond. Objects in the night sky present us with distance and size quantity problems beyond our imagination. We're going to take this ball, for example. Imagine that the sun was shrunk down to the size of about an inch, about the size of this ball. Does anybody know how far away the Earth would be then? Well, it's about 8 feet away. And the nearest star is about 500 miles away. So think like suburbs of Cincinnati somewhere. There's another ball about this big. So the distances are just huge. Knowing what we do about the development of life here on Earth, what could be out there similar to us, and do they also look beyond in wonder? On February 1990, the Voyager 1 space probe took an image of the Earth from 6 billion kilometers away at the request of astronomer Carl Sagan. And if you remember the ball, that's from about 260 feet away. Every person who ever is or ever was lives on that single pale blue dot. Greater understanding of our place in the cosmos can help us show how fragile our existence actually is. Knowing the vastness of the cosmos and what we could exist beyond, the Fermi Paradox will help us put this all into perspective. And you probably wonder, what is the Fermi Paradox? The Fermi Paradox is a contradiction between the estimates of probabilities of extraterrestrial civilizations and our lack of observable evidence. The paradox was first proposed by Italian physicist Enrico Fermi in an informal discussion in 1950, where he basically looked up toward the sky and said, if there's a multitude of advanced civilizations out there in the cosmos, where are they? Why don't we see spaceships and stuff like that zooming around in the night sky? The Fermi Paradox suggests that given the age of the Earth at about 4.5 billion years and the age of the universe at about 13.8 billion, there's plenty of time in the past for intelligent life to develop. As you can see here on this chart, there's a hypothetical planet X that was born about 8 billion years ago, and the Earth born about 4.5 billion years ago, and it leaves a gap of about 4 billion years for life to not only develop, but to be ahead of where we are currently in technology, considering that the technological age only lasted about, 2,000 years to get from some form of mechanical science all the way up to space travel, where we are today. And life on Earth took about 2 billion years to develop. Another problem is, how do you estimate this? How do you guess how many civilizations are out there? Well, you can use something called the Drake equation. This is kind of a quick estimate that you can use with these numbers. N is the number of communicating civilizations. L is the lifetime of these civilizations. F is the fraction of them with planets, life, intelligent life. Those are currently communicating. And just to get back to the L really quick, That is saying how long they last, but the factor there is unknown. What could end an intelligent civilization, we're not quite sure of. All right, many solutions have been suggested to the Fermi Paradox, and they're very complex in scope. I'll just give you some very popular ones. One of them is that we're the first, that we've gotten a head start in technology, and so there's nothing else for us to deserve. Yeah, observe. I mean, there's nothing else in the cosmos that's as developed. They could still be singular cell life and what have you. There could also be something called a great filter. There's something that may happen that ends the development of all intelligent species. What this is, we don't know. It could be prior to intelligence. It could be moving from singular cell life all the way up to multiple cellular life. It could be that they all reach singularity, some kind of technological singularity at some point. They just all kind of conform into one singular brain. As ridiculous as that may sound. We could also be isolated or alone. We may live in an empty neighborhood of the galaxy or perhaps the universe. If you plug certain numbers into the Drake equation, some of them could give estimates as low as 1 to 2 civilizations per galaxy, so it wouldn't be, it would be understandable that we couldn't see anything out there right now. And this is kind of a scary one. ET could in fact be predatory. ET could detect and destroy competition by seeing early signs of technology arise in some civilizations and simply seek them out and destroy them, so they have no competition. There are many possibilities for a lack of observable evidence. Some good sources for this, more for solutions, would be like Wait But Why does an excellent blog. There's some great articles about the Fermi Paradox. Stephen Hawking has written extensively about it, so if you read any of his books, you can get some information. Famous cosmologists like Carl Sagan did some writing on it. Physicists like Sean Carroll. And even NASA and world governments must consider these possibilities for our own safety. All right, the Fermi Paradox also affects how we explore and interact with the cosmos. The Voyager 1 space probe was launched on September 5th, 1977, and at a speed of 10.5 miles per second, or 38,000 miles per hour, is now the farthest object away from the Earth, man-made object. Still another 40,000 years at that speed for it to reach the nearest star, if it was even pointed towards it. So right now, if you remember our one-inch sun ball, that Voyager is about 525 feet away. NASA is currently developing a long-term Mars exploration program that charts a course for the next 2 decades, and it's to help see how humans survive long-term in space. Also, limits to interstellar flights may shed light on, you know, solutions to the Fermi Paradox. We also have exoplanet hunters like the Kepler program and the Future Nexus program from NASA that will help us understand, you know, why we don't see anything. NASA and the ESA and other agencies are also considering things like biological contamination, and that could be just direct contamination from our probes or reverse contamination. Like, we could end up contaminating an entire ecosystem from, you know, a moon or another planet and not even know it. And another, a really great source for that would be NASA has a website that lists all their future missions, and exclusively the Nexus mission, because that's another exoplanet finder, and that talks in depth about some of the issues with running into civilizations in or outside of the galaxy. Ideas and noticeable and perhaps unintentional human interstellar interactions not only pertain to spacecraft, but we have been sending radio signals into space for about 110 years. With the first signal passing about 15,000 stars along the way. SETI is the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. They have been scanning the cosmos for signals since about 1970. What you see right there is one of their receivers called the Big Ear. I think that's somewhere in Ohio, and that is the receiver that received the WOW signal, if you remember hearing anything about that. It's the undetectable signal that we received. I can't remember what constellation it was from, but there's still no explanation known for that signal. SETI would also like to pursue active searches or messaging to extraterrestrial intelligence, but the problem with that is they're meeting a lot of resistance from scientists and a lot from the public, because, you know, the last solution I gave you to the Fermi Paradox, the ET could be predatory. We don't know what we're dealing with, so maybe we shouldn't be shouting out into the open jungle. All right, what humanity learns for our interactions with local space will undoubtedly transfer to some understanding of possible technologies needed for better interstellar interactions and more empirical data about what is beyond. As you can see in this cartoon, this is kind of yet another play on the ET is predatory thing. Some of the reasons why we might want to consider being more safe about what we do, what messages we send, and what kind of probes we send out of space. In conclusion, we need to understand that interstellar space represents a frontier that, if not physically conquered, at least needs to be understood for the safety of mankind. The deep philosophical and cosmological questions that arise within the Fermi Paradox are important because they assist us in informing an understanding about where we are, who we will meet in the cosmos. All right, if anybody has any questions about solutions, today's space capabilities, cosmic distance, anything like that, feel free to speak up. Yes?
Popular conspiracy theory is we are getting signals, but the government is protecting us from it. What do you think of that? Do you think it's possible?
I don't think it's possible. The government can't keep many secrets, as we know, and with modern technology and leaks that happen all the time, I don't think that that's something that they could keep a secret from us. Considering also that there's a lot of amateur astronomers out there, and a lot of people from SETI, they're amateurs that are people just like me and you that take their free time to go on the computer and listen for signals. I mean, there would be something there for these people, and somebody would say something. Anymore?
Yeah, you said earlier that that little ball, the Earth, was the only thing that is ever, or the only thing that's ever lived on it, or in the universe there. I mean, how do you know that for sure? Or
that comment was referring to people exclusively. All humans ever been alive have been born and have died on that pale blue dot.
Okay.
As far as we know.
As far as we know, yes. Go ahead.
So where does the Fermi paradox fit in with creationism?
Well, it doesn't really. It would actually negate the fact of.
So then does it toe the line with evolution?
Absolutely. It's a totally scientific inquiry. It doesn't dive into, although it almost seems like the claim itself, you know, it is philosophical, as much as it is cosmological, but it is, it's kind of a shot in the dark. Although I'd say it's taken seriously by scientists, the claim itself, even though it follows science, it is just deeply conjecture. It doesn't say much about, you know, what we know. Because the problem with, if you take something like the Drake equation, like I gave you earlier, we only have one data point. That's us. So you plug that into the formula, it does nothing. It's all guesswork. So no, it doesn't follow along with creationism at all.
So Fermi being one of the most renowned physicists out there, and actually quite local to us, does he, I mean, is there a fact basis behind everything, or is this all, at this point, I guess, not theoretical data, but hypothetical data?
Yes, it is. All we do is we take what we can currently understand, what we know, especially from stuff that we get from, like, let's say, for example, the 1800 exoplanets that Kepler has discovered. And we take data that we know from that, you know, how close they are to the Cinderella zone of the planet, you know, where you can have liquid water and stuff like that, and, you know, how many of those could evolve based on the age of the star and stuff. Like, so the more we know, the more accurate kind of those figures are that can get plugged into that equation. And so, like I said, we have the Nexus probe coming up, and that's going to be even better than Kepler was at discovering exoplanets. And that's more empirical data that we can use to throw into the formula.
Let's say that ET is predatory. Why would they not have attacked us already? Like, is there a possible, like, there's a theory that they're watching us? Is that a possible theory that goes along with this?
There's a solution to the Fermi paradox called the zoo Earth hypothesis that fits well into this. It's basically humans are treated like that we're all in a zoo, and we're simply being observed to, you know, help them scientifically discover how an intelligent species develops. You know, we're just kind of left alone, maybe until we get to a certain point. Maybe the point that a predatory civilization would detect has not occurred yet. Maybe it's some kind of, like how NASA has M-Drive, maybe it's some kind of capability that bends space-time, you know, or some kind of energy signal that the Earth could put out that would be, you know, loud enough for a civilization from hundreds of light years away to hear it. Questions? Okay, thank you very much.
To hear it.
So what are you saying? Are you saying
like there's a civilization that almost mirrors us, like in whatever way, ever biology they're in, but like they're sending out frequencies, but we can't hear it because
like they're sending out microwaves and we're listening on cell phones or something, like we're listening on TV.
Yeah, like they're like sending something else, but we can't hear that.
Yeah, that's very possible. And if you say biologically, they've developed about the same, and you know, not taking relativity into context when we think about this, we can't really read or understand a signal sent even with our own equipment right now, you know, at any distance. I mean, if we sent the signal to, let's say, Alpha Centauri, which is 4.3 light years away, I mean, to make it strong enough to make it understandable in any kind of wavelength would be pretty difficult to do. You'd have to be very direct. You'd have to pick and choose the stellar bodies that you want to send signals to. You'd have to say, okay, you can't just send a broad signal to, let's just say, the Orion Nebula, and say, let's hope there's something out there. I mean, even though our signals right now are currently broad, you know, television from the 40s and 50s is reaching other stars currently, thousands of other stars. And that signal is so weak, you couldn't differentiate it from white noise, as you said earlier. It would be nearly impossible, unless there's some technology out there that we don't know about.
Do you think possibly that that one time, you know, there could have been life on Mars, because the sun, you know, it slowly burns out after so many years? Do you think billions and billions of years, Mars could have been a planet that was actually, there was life on it, possibly? Because I've heard they think that actually there could be something going on way underneath the surface of Mars. And then as it got colder, all this other stuff built up on Mars, you know, the, like you say, the carbons and everything, and the life could be underneath there. But because if the sun years ago was brighter and it burned out, then it went from Mars to Earth that there was life.
Wouldn't it be bad if there was life on Mars? Then it burned out, wouldn't that mean that the filter is ahead of us?
It could be. There's actually several questions here. He actually has two answers I can kind of give you to your question here. For one thing, you're talking about kind of what Curiosity has discovered recently. NASA's space rover Curiosity, if you know anything about it. And it has kind of decided that, you know, there's liquid water underneath the surface of Mars, and we can see floodplains on Mars. So there obviously was liquid water at one point. Why that is, could there still be something under the surface that survived, like a singular cell organism? Yeah, there absolutely could. Now, if you're talking about life from Mars transferring to Earth sometime in the very distant past, you know, to help seed it, that's a concept cosmologists call transpermia, where some kind of life form launches off a planet, let's say a meteorite hits Mars or something like that, and a meteor lands on the planet Earth, and some of that singular cellular life is still alive. That's something that could happen too. So in essence, we could all be Martians if you take that into consideration. Yeah.
So thinking about that process, going back with the Egyptians and their use of scarabs, scarabs were believed to have come in as a bacteria through a meteorite, if you will, and essentially they're born from nothing. Is that kind of along the same process here, where you're using evolution, but yet the Big Bang and appearance, I guess, is it, if that's the question, where he's bringing Mars over, life from Mars to Earth via an asteroid, or like something that could have inhabited Mars also inhabited Earth, but in a different way and through evolutionary processes have made the differentiation where that which is on Mars now, having survived, you know, different exotemperatures, extremes, we have different types of bacteria and strains around here, you know, on our planet that can survive some, I mean, thermophiles, they're able to withstand extreme temperatures or extreme colds within lavas or in...
on the seabed by thermal vents, which NASA does a lot of work with that when they look at places like Europa.
Or even glaciers.
Or it could be aliens.
And stuff like that, I mean, absolutely.
It could have been that they came hundreds of thousands of years ago and dropped off these scarabs or whatever and found, like, no life form, so they left and said it's not
possible to think that the Earth was actually intentionally seeded by intelligent beings. There's also, I explained the concept of kind of transpermia within a solar system. There's also a kind of a galactic version of that, where, as you know, the Milky Way, the sun moves around the Milky Way. It takes several billion years for the sun to move around, but all the time we're having bodies come closer to the sun. I mean, Alpha Centauri wasn't always the closest star to the sun. I mean, at some points there was some stars within a light year of the sun, and they're saying bodies can be recaptured, you know, from one Oort cloud to another, and you can have that crash into the inner solar system, so you could actually have life be seeded by an actual another stellar body, another star outside our own solar system. But yes, to get back to what you were saying about the extremophiles, this is when NASA considers searching for life now, this is something that they really consider, this is their big shot right there. This is why they consider planets like Europa with possible oceans kilometers underneath the surface, because they're looking for these thermal vents where these extremophiles can live. And that's why planets like, I don't know, there's another moon of Saturn that they're looking at very closely, Enceladus, that has an underground water ocean that we actually know of. We can see the vents from it. And the trick is now is just to get some probes down there and see what we find. And maybe we'll find that it's related. Maybe there's some kind of connected, you know, RNA or DNA that you can actually say that, yes, life from the Earth could have came from this.
So, I forget the name of the planet, but there's almost an identical solar system that's not that far away in, like, space terms that's identical to Earth. And they're saying, it's not like Stephen Hawking, something about Stephen Hawking, like how it's really identical. How do we not know that that doesn't have any life on it? Because it has, like, almost everything that Earth has. It's like...
Well, we don't, because we really don't have no way of detecting it right now. One of the things that NASA hopes to do with the... they have a new telescope coming up, the James Webb telescope. It's kind of going to be Hubble, the Hubble telescope's replacement. What their hopes are with that is it's going to be able to peer close enough to identify what's in the atmosphere of some of these exoplanets. Because right now, it's just guesswork when it comes to types of stars. We can say, okay, this is a G-type star. It should last about this long. Its zone where liquid water could exist should be about between this area and this area. And there's maybe one or two planets in some of these exoplanet solar systems that could have water. But that's all right now. That's all we can really guess. Until we get that better equipment up there, then we can actually say, okay, this atmosphere contains things like oxygen, nitrogen, or methane to levels where we could say